Hey everyone, Patrick CK here with part 5 of my guide to help make the transition from SketchUp to Blender. This is probably the part that many of you have been waiting for, and one that took me the longest to get even a basic handle on. At the onset, and as I've mentioned before, I'm no guru, and this part of Blender is one of the most important aspects of the whole program. And because of that, it is a bit of a complex system to learn. Coming from SketchUp and learning how Blender paints was a significant mind shift, but like many other parts of this transition, the shift is for the better. The results you can get from Blender's built-in rendering systems are simply nothing SketchUp can even come close to. Done right, you can get photorealistic renders, and even if you don't need that level of realism, the system is still amazing and may give you that added wow factor on your projects. We really need to start off with simply forgetting everything you know about SketchUp's painting system. Not that there was much to it to begin with, but again, this is a whole different system. Blender uses what's called a PBR material system, PBR standing for physics-based rendering. Already you can tell we're working on next level stuff here. PBR in the simplest terms allows you to mimic 3D looking textures with all the detail from just 2D images, using a layered node system. If that sounds complicated, well, that's because it kind of is, but even a basic layout will create impressive results. The material property system is a massive part of Blender. In turn, this section will be broken up into 3 parts. Part 1 will start off with the basics of how to add colors to your model and make them shine. Then part 2 will go over how to apply materials and textures using your own or downloaded texture images. Lastly, I'll cover some of the basics of using the material node system to add some cool PBR textures to your models and renders. We'll start with simply adding some color to our model. To start, we'll need to create a material to apply to our model. Out of the box, there's not a library of materials like in SketchUp, but you can import everything you've used before or get even more from other users. We're going to focus on the material properties pane in the properties panel. The first time you look at this, you'll have a single default material that your entire model will use. If you select it, you can rename the default to something more appropriate. Now let's start by changing the color. To do this, click on the white bar next to base color and choose a new color from the color picker. Choose the brightness or enter your own codes using the options below. At this point, you probably didn't see anything change, and that's because we need to change our viewport shading setting to material preview or render preview. For the sake of this tutorial, we'll stay in the material preview mode because render preview will require some lighting setup that we haven't talked about yet. After you switch, you'll see your whole model is the color we just chose. You can go back and change the color anytime if you like. Here is where we get just an inkling of the power that Blender's PBR system brings to bear. You've probably noticed that besides the color picker, there are a ton of other options to play with. All these settings are actually part of the most elementary node of Blender's material node system, called the principled BSDF node. BSDF stands for Bidirectional Scattering Distribution Function, which is just a fancy way to say how light reacts with the surface of a material. I'll go over a few of the options that I at least know how they work, but I'll also leave a few links to the real Blender gurus that'll go over all the settings in detail. Like always, I encourage you to play around with these settings yourself. I find it fascinating how much detail you can add with just the right values. The best way to see how these settings affect the look of the material is to apply them to a sphere. So first we'll skip down to the metallic option. As the name implies, this gives your material a metallic shine. Quick note, all these sliders work in the same way. 0 applies no effect, and 1 applies the full effect. And any value in between is just a blending of 0 and 1. You can click and drag to slide or enter a specific value. If we slide this back and forth, you'll see how it looks on our new marble here. Specular indicates how shiny the object is, basically how much light it will reflect. Specular tint determines if the light being reflected is the same color as the object or the color of the light source. Roughness defines how clear the reflections are on the surface, 0 being a perfect mirror, and 1 being almost no reflection. Even with just these 4 settings, you can see that our marble already looks way more realistic than anything we could have hoped to produce in SketchUp. This is just a single shade of color. Imagine what we could do with actual texture images. We actually don't have to imagine, we just have to wait for the next tutorial. Moving on, we obviously don't want the whole model to be the same color. Let's create some more materials and assign them around the model. Back at the top of the Material Properties pane, select the plus sign to create a new material slot. Then select New. The new material will have a default name that you can change like before. We'll go ahead and change the base color again. Unlike the default material, this new one will need to be applied to the faces of our object. First, select the object and enter Edit Mode by hitting Tab. In Face Selection Mode, select a face or multiple faces by holding Shift and clicking each one. With all the faces you want selected, back in the Materials pane, select the new material if it's not already selected, and click on Assign. Now the selected faces all have the new material applied. You can keep repeating this process until you have all the materials you want. You can always go back anytime to the material options and change the color or any value of the principled BSDF node. Up until now, we've only been working on one object. All the materials we've created can be easily applied to any object we add. If we insert another object like this isosphere and go to the materials property window and click the globe icon, a list of all the materials we've created so far will be shown. Simply select one and it will automatically be applied to the whole object. At this moment, the material is linked, so if you update the color, it will change it across all the objects that have the material applied. If you like the way the material looks, but you want to change, for instance, the color, just for this one object, you can unlink it, i.e. duplicate it, by selecting the number next to the name. This value just indicates the number of objects that have this material applied. After you select it, a sequence of numbers will be appended to the material name, signaling that this is a new independent copy. Now you can rename it and apply any changes you want without affecting the other objects. Even though we're just playing with shades of colors and only utilizing the principled material options, I hope you can appreciate the potential of the system. It'll become even more apparent once we start diving into the next couple of tutorials. One last note, the image in the reflection of the object can be changed by clicking the down arrow next to the viewport shading choices. Here you have 8 presets that you can switch between to see how your material will look in different environments. That's it for this episode. I hope it helps you out. If it did, please leave a like and share so others can find this content in the future. Until next time, this has been Patrick CK. Goodbye.